JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for November the 18th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded lower against the majority of the other G10 currencies on Tuesday and during the Asian session Wednesday. It gained only versus Aussie, CAD and Kiwi in that order, while it underperformed the most against the Yen, the Pound and the Swiss franc. Now, although the greenback was mostly lower, the strengthening of the Yen and franc and the weakening of the commodity-linked Aussie, Loonie and Kiwi suggest that markets turned risk off at some point yesterday. Looking at the performance in the equity world, we see that EU stock indices were mixed yesterday, while the US ones finished in the red, losing on average 0.42% each. As for today, in Asia, even though China Shanghai Composite is up 0.22%, Japan's Nikkei 225 tumbled 1.10%. Now, following the latest rally on promising vaccine trials, investors decided to abandon risk-linked assets, perhaps due to coronavirus infections accelerating again yesterday, and or due to the softer than expected US retail sales for October, which highlighted the lack of new fiscal aid in the US. In any case, we will maintain a positive view with regards to the broader market appetite, and we will treat yesterday's retreat as a corrective pullback. After the vaccine-driven rally, a small corrective setback due to some profit-taking appears more than normal to us. Yes, the COVID era is not behind us yet, and thus more months of restrictions and economic slowdown are ahead of us until any vaccine is ready for distribution. However, as we noted several times in the last few days, we are now closer in finding the cure, and anything suggesting more progress may continue to support sentiment. Now back to the currencies, the British pound was the second winner in line among the G10s, coming under strong buying interest following the news that UK's Brexit chief negotiator David Frost told Prime Minister Johnson to expect a trade deal with the EU early next week. This followed news last week that Dominic Cummings was set to leave the government, something that, according to market chatter, increases the chances for an accord, as Cummings was seen as a hardline Brexiteer. Remember that recently we've been highlighting that the British currency is likely to stay mostly linked to developments surrounding the Brexit landscape, and all this adds credence to our view. Therefore, we will stick to our guns that anything pointing towards an accord may prove supportive for the pound, while the opposite may be true if news suggests that the two sides are finding it difficult to reach common ground. In case we get more optimistic headlines regarding a deal and conditional upon risk on returning into the markets, the pound is likely to perform better against the safe havens, the likes of the US dollar, the Japanese yen and the Swiss franc. Now, as for today's events, during the early EU morning, we already got the UK CPIs for October. Both the headline and core rates rose more than anticipated, but the pound barely reacted, confirming our view that GBP traders are likely to keep their gaze locked on developments surrounding Brexit rather than economic data. From the Eurozone, we get the final CPIs for October, but as it is always the case, they are expected to confirm their preliminary estimates. We get CPIs for October from Canada as well. The headline rate is expected to have ticked down to 0.4% year over year from 0.5%, While there is no forecast available, there is no forecast available for neither the core rate nor the trimmed mean one. At its latest meeting, the Bank of Canada kept interest rates unchanged and scaled back its QE program, noting that the economic outlook has evolved largely as anticipated in the July monetary policy report. Thus, a downtick in headline inflation is unlikely to raise speculation for officials reversing their decision at the upcoming gathering, namely expanding their QE purchases. From the US, we have built-in permits and housing starts for October. Both are expected to have increased somewhat from September. As for tonight, during the Asian session Thursday, Australia's employment report for October is scheduled to be released. The unemployment rate is expected to have risen to 7.2% from 6.9%, while the net change in employment is forecast to show that the economy has lost 30,000 jobs after losing 29,500 in September. Another set of soft Australian data may increase speculation with regards to more easing from the RBA and thereby hurt somewhat the Aussie. However, we expect the risk-linked currency to stay mostly driven by developments surrounding the broader market sentiment. As we already noted, we expect investors' morale to stay supported, and thus we would treat any potential retreat in the Aussie as just a corrective move. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.